It's time to get inside the Giants home.
Let's go, let's go, let's go.
On Giants.com.
I like it.
And the Giants mobile app.
Boom. Give me some juice.
Part of the Giants podcast network.
Let's roll.
Paul DeTino and Howard Cross here on the Giants huddle after the 14-3 preseason opener, a victory for the Giants over the Detroit Lions in a rainy MetLife Stadium. And Howard, you know, preseason openers, a lot of people, you know, they don't know what to expect. Are they going to see some big plays? Are they not going to see big plays? How many stars are they going to see? How many are they not going to see? Regardless of the circumstances and who played, I think Brian Daboll's got to be fairly happy with what he saw.
Yeah, I think he's happy with what he saw. I think mostly when you think about this year, we're trying to figure out mostly is the offensive line going to be intact. You know, Daniel Jones has had a couple of rough years, and he's been hurt pretty severely the last couple of years. And what I've seen in practice, and they practiced this week against the Lions, and now even into the preseason game with second, third, and whatever group of guys playing, the quarterbacks had time. The quarterbacks weren't getting hit a lot. The running backs had time. They weren't getting hit in the backfield. And when you see stuff like that, you can tell that the team's making some real progress.
All right. Now, tonight, of course, we did not see the Giants starters outside of, I believe, Tay Banks might have been the only starter on either side of the ball who actually started. Neighbors did start. Neighbors did start as well. All right, but let me ask you this. We talk about the offensive line. They had Drew Lock back there. He left the game with a sore hip, and then Tommy DeVito came in. Your assessment there as those guys tried to win backup jobs, because we know that maybe outside of Stinney, the guys who play tonight are probably not in line for starting roles.
You're talking about the quarterbacks? Or
The offensive linemen.
The offensive line did a good job all around. I think they gave up maybe one actual sack. I think a couple times when Drew got hit, he held onto the ball a little long. You got to get rid of it after 3 seconds. So that's something that's different. We're not used to seeing quarterbacks have that much time to throw the ball, so that was kind of good. But I think they did a great job. I think they did a good job in the run game, opening in some holes. Now, I don't want everybody to get too excited because that's basic runs. That's, you know, that's power, not even power. It's like a double team up to the second level. Mm-hmm. You get your guy, you push down on this guy, we're just going to run to the second level. It's the old school football that they ran. They did a good job doing it.
All right, so now we saw the team run for over 150 yards tonight, to your point, and it was Eric Gray, and it was Turbo Miller. Mm-hmm. Even though Tracy also had some runs in there early, those other two guys were really the bulk of the run game, and they looked like they knew what they were doing in there.
They did a good job. I think Gray had did something I didn't expect. I didn't think he could outrun anybody, but he did. He did. He got out in the open field, made a guy miss, and once he did, it was a foot race. I'm like, oh, wow. And he showed something that I don't remember him having outside of college. Maybe he showed it a couple times. And then you have the young man you just mentioned. He did a great job reading the plays, putting his foot in the ground. You wouldn't think that someone like that would be taking a lot of contact, but he took contact. He did good breaking off hits. Gray also caught the ball great out of the backfield, which was another plus for him. You know, the more versatile you are, the more opportunities you're going to get in games.
Yeah, so that running backs room right now looks like that's going to be a heck of a competition over the next two preseason games, because we already know that Tracy's had a great camp to this point, and they got him out of there quickly as the other two guys showed that they want to fight for these jobs too.
Yeah, but you know, you got your starting running back out, you got your second guy out, and Tracy, then you got to make sure these other guys are going to get some reps. They got to show what they're going to do. You can't, even though they're having good practices and stuff, and you practice against another team, you can't get enough reps. You can't get enough live reps at that. So that it was good for them to get in there.
All right. Now, we know Brian Daboll was calling the plays tonight, doubling as the offensive coordinator and the head coach. It's clear that in the beginning of the game, when Malik Nabers, the first-round draft pick, was in the game, they wanted to try to get him the ball. Mm-hmm. I think the stadium would have erupted had he caught one. It just didn't happen, though.
Yeah, he did a good job. I think Nabers ran a route. I think he'll go back and look at that tape. He'll see he ran a kind of a deep comeback, and when the quarterback scrambles to that side, he breaks the pocket, then you just got to run a go. Because once that happens, you got to run a go. I think another time someone broke the pocket, and you know the receivers kind of stopped because they were just like, okay, the play's over. Like, it's not practice. You've got to keep running. You got to use a little bit of scramble rules. And I think that's what they'll discuss that with them and say, hey, look, guys, there are plays to be had if you're willing to run and go get the ball. So I think that's going to be a big moment for him.
Okay, so before I move over to defense, let me ask you about Tommy DeVito, because he got three quarters plus of work tonight, mm-hmm. and this is his second season now mm-hmm. with the Giants. He knows more about what he's doing. Coach says he looks more confident, more poised, seems to have a better understanding of the playbook. Mm-hmm. What did you see from him tonight? Again, this is another guy who wants to make sure that the Giants can't cut him, because they may or may not keep three quarterbacks.
I think the Giants are probably going to have to keep three quarterbacks after you just saw Drew get banged up and it's just some, you know, on happenstance of holding the ball a little bit long. So I don't think you have the luxury of not keeping three quarterbacks on your roster. That's one. Number two, I thought he looked very poised. He missed a couple of passes throwing over the middle, and he got a couple balls batted down. But for the most part, he did a good job, you know, orchestrating the offense and doing what Coach Dable said. There was not a lot of back and forth from the sideline when he came over. It was more like, okay, good job, pats on the back, and that's what you want to see out of your players, all of them, when they come off the field.
One thing we've seen over the course of training camp is that there have been some busted coverages in the secondary mm-hmm. that have led to big plays. Mm-hmm. That didn't happen tonight. And I think that's going to be something that Shane Bowen, the new defensive coordinator, is going to be happy about.
I think it didn't happen tonight. And also, it was more probably predicated on the pass rush and the pressure. The pressure was getting to guys, so there wasn't a whole lot of time for them to, like, have plays bust and go over the top. The first group that was in there did a good job. The second group that was in there got even better, and the third group that went in there was even better than that. So the more pressure you put on the quarterback, the harder it is for them to have time to do some of the things we're just talking about with neighbors and the guys were, you know, doing the scramble drills and coming back and breaking open. Mm-hmm. And I just think that the pressure they had, and that wasn't even the first unit, was pretty tremendous. They did a great job in the run game, stuffing the run, coming off blocks, linebackers filling holes where we've, you know, lamented for the last couple of years about the tackling and how bad the tackling has been. We saw a lot of guys, you know, one-on-one tackles in the backfield, one-on-one tackles out in space, and guys coming to help. But the one-on-one, not overrunning the play, not you know, throwing your body and not bringing your feet, it looked a lot better.
Looked like a lot of guys hustling to the ball, a lot of team tackles, yeah. Which is always a good thing.
Well, when you're excited and the guys start making plays, everybody tries to get it on the camera. It was a lot of fun.
We heard from Coach Dable and also Shane Bowen, this defensive line combination or competition is going to be very tough. We saw some of that tonight. Did anybody particularly kind of catch your eye as moving ahead of the pack?
I think Basham did a good job. You know, a lot of the guys, he flashed a lot. He had a lot of early pressures on the quarterback. I think he had one or two sacks, a few quarterback hits. So, like, he really kind of showed that, you know, he's trying to get in so he could be that guy. That fourth rusher in third down situations. Ojulari, I was looking for him to, you know, kind of show something. I didn't really see a lot out of him, but he didn't have a lot of plays. Mm-hmm. So I think some of the young kids at D-tackle are going to be able to come in and stuff to run. They look good. And, you know, and that's what you want to see. You want to see the guys that are going to come in. You know Nacho, you know Dex are going to be up front. You're not worried about those two guys. You need two other guys that's going to back them up. And they can come in and rotate with them. You know that Burns and Thibodeau are both going to be on the outside. They're going to be great players, but you're going to need two other guys to come in there and back them up. And you know, I would like for it to be three and outs every time. but unfortunately, it won't be three and outs every time. So you're going to need guys to come in and spell guys and give them a break.
Well, they did have a couple of stops in the red zone that did turn the ball back over to the offense on fourth down. And that's always a nice thing to see.
Yes and no. You got to take that with a grain of salt. You know, Dan was trying to get his fourth down plays in and make sure that he could get some live opportunities at fourth down plays. And it's a good thing that we stopped him. But at the same time, they were trying to, you know, they wanted to run as much of their offense they possibly could run, you know, and Coach, you know, Dable and those guys appreciate that.
All right. We talked about the pass rush having a big impact on the Lions not hitting some big plays. But did you see something out of these young corners who were fighting for jobs as well, and even the safeties, that maybe kind of stuck out to you?
I thought that early in the game, the corners did a really good job. I thought they may have been a little handsy. I don't think they were calling it. And then in the second half, especially late in the second half, The officials started like, that's passive. I think they were like, come on, let's get the game, let's get the game. Come on, let's move. And all of a sudden they were like, okay, we can't just let it just be a free-for-all. So I think as the game went on, it got a little tighter. But the thing I've noticed most about them is that they were in position. They were playing their leverage. There wasn't a lot of space. There was no deep balls. There was nobody beating them from behind. They didn't even attempt any balls going over their head. So that's what you really want to see.
Okay, final question has to do with special teams. Mm-hmm. What did you think of the new kickoff rule and how it worked tonight? Or, for that matter, something that maybe surprised you or you didn't like very much about it?
The only thing that surprised me about the whole kickoff thing was, I think one time either he missed the kick or he squibbed it. And the ball didn't go the distance, right, and it hit the ground, and they threw a flag. And I'm like, what?
And the Giants got the ball at the 40.
Yeah, and I'm like, what just happened? I'm like, I got the whole rule down. I was like, he squibbed it, and they get the ball at the 40, and then I'm like, oh. So I think that's going to force teams to either kick it all the way through the end zone, because you can't kick it to the end zone and think that they won't return it. You can't be 5 yards deep in the end zone and think they won't return it, because I saw the holes develop. But the returner didn't quite get to them in time. Mm-hmm. Was standing, 'cause I stood in the end zone just so I could see what it was going to look like. And you could tell they took angles and got on the edges of guys and made them run big bubbles.
Okay.
And when they're running the big bubble, if the returner is, you know, once he gets the ball, he's got to start up the field. Some returners are cutting right and cutting left to try to, like, you know, set the block up. If you run straight ahead at that bubble, it's going to be very interesting.
Howard Cross, always good to see you. So the Giants beat the Detroit Lions 14-3 in the preseason opener of both teams. This has been the Giants Huddle with rapid reaction to the Giants' victory. I'm Paul Dottino. We'll talk to you next time.